from where we left yesterday. So example 8.15. So a merry-go-round modeled as a disc. So again, that information is important. It's modeled as a disc. So that gives you what moment of inertia you're going to use. As a disc of mass 100 kg and radius 2 meters is rotating in a horizontal plane about a frictionless vertical axle. Figure 8.33, that's the figure you're seeing on the bottom right, is an overhead view of the system. A student with mass 60 kg jumps on the rim of the merry-go-round. So I explained yesterday, say rim, it means that this lady, this student is on the edge of this, right? So meaning her distance from the axis of rotation is the radius of this disc. Then the system's angular speed decreases to 2 rad per second, which makes sense. When something gets heavier, the speed decreases, isn't it? Or we expect the speed to decrease. Okay, so if the student walks slowly from the edge toward the center, find the angular speed of the system when she reaches a point 0.5 meters from the center. So they are basically telling us to say the information that we've given you so far, you can calculate the moment of inertia of the system. We've given you the initial angular velocity or angular speed. Therefore, you can calculate the new moment of inertia. Why am I saying the new moment of inertia? Because the student has moved, she has changed her radius. So if she's changed her radius, her distance from the point for from the axis of rotation, this then entails that the moment of inertia has changed as well, isn't it? Okay, so let's just take note of that. Then so B, find the change in the system's rotational kinetic energy caused by her movement, to radius 0.5 meters. Then C, find the work done on the student as she walks to the radius of 0.5 meters. So in my reading of the question, I'm sure you may have been getting the hints on how we are going to handle this question. So why do I really like talking about how to handle the questions? Because it's not about just us answering the questions and then we go our way. In that way, then we are not helping one another. So the idea is for you to understand the principles which are being used here. So what we are going to do then is, so let's go to our board and see what we can do. So then, what have we been given? So first of all, like I was explaining on how we're going to do it, we want to find the moment of inertia for the what? For the disk on its own and for the student. Then we are going to add them to find the what? To find the moment of inertia of the system. Because remember that the first question is asking us about the system, the angular speed of the system. So meaning we have to find the individual moment of inertia for the student and for the disk. We add them, then we've got the moment of inertia of the what? Of the system. And then from there we can proceed with the conservation of angular momentum. So then what we are going to do is, so then we are going to say, so moment of inertia for the disk. Again, they told us that it's a disk, so it's going to be this. Okay, so it's just basically the mass times the radius squared of the rim. So the mass, they told us it's 100 kg, and then the radius is 2 meters, which we have to square. So we're going to get 200 kg. Okay, kg meter squared. Then for the student, student, let's make the student different from the, so remember for the student, we are going to put initial. Why are we putting initial? Because the student, the final moment of initial for the student is going to be different because she changed positions, right? From when she was at the edge of the disc of the merry-go-round, and when she came closer to the what? When she came closer to the center. So that's why we've put that I there to just say moment of inertia of the student initial. Okay. Then for this, she's just like a particle here, right? She's just like a particle. So that's why we're using that moment of inertia. So, what we're going to do is her mass, it was 60 kg. Then her radius, I explained why it's 2 meters, because the question says she was at the rim. So I mean, she was pretty much almost at the edge of the merry-go-round, which is the same as on the outer surfaces of this merry-go-round. So that's why her radius is 2. So once we've done that, then now we want now to calculate what was the initial angular momentum. Remember that L is for angular momentum. So what do we do? Remember, it's going to be the what? It's going to be the moment of inertia of the system multiply the initial angular speed. So how do we find the moment of inertia of the system? We simply add the moment of inertia of the disk and the moment of inertia of the student, the initial, of course, then multiply by that, right? So adding that, so we're going to have 200 kg that, then 240 kg meter squared, then you're going to have the angular speed. They told us it was what, 2 radian per second, isn't it? So then what are we going to have? Then we are going to have 440. So you're going to have 440 and then 2 rad second. So 2 rad second, that's going to be 880. So it's going to be kg meter squared per second. Okay, so once you've done that, so meaning we found the initial. So that's the initial. Now remember, here there is conservation, there's conservation of moment of inertia. So meaning the initial moment of inertia has to be equal to the final. Okay, and that's where we are going to find our final angular speed, which the question is asking us to find. So we know that the angular, or rather that the moment of inertia of the disk remains the same, but for the student it's going to change. So remember, for the disk it's going to remain the same, nothing has happened to the disk, its radius hasn't changed, its mass hasn't changed, so it's like that. But for the student, remember, so SF, that's for student, the final position. Then the mass, of course, her mass hasn't changed, but her radius has changed. She's now closer to the what? She's now closer, so that's 60. Let me write properly. So her radius, so she's now closer to the what? She's now closer to the axis of rotation. It's a she, right? Okay, so that, then we have that. So her new moment of inertia is what? Is 15. So meaning, what's then the final what's the final moment of inertia of the system. So moment of inertia for the system, the final. So this one that we had here was the what? Was the initial, okay? That was the initial. The final is going to be what? So we are getting the 200 km that then plus 15. Then what we're going to have is 215. So then we can now write the what, that equation that I've put in a rectangle there, right? Then we're now going to relate the two and say the initial angular momentum to the final is what? These are equal. So then what you're going to have is, here we already found our answer, isn't it? It was 880, yeah? 880. Then here we know that what's our final. Then it's final, because remember that angular momentum is what? Moment of inertia times angular what? Angular velocity or angular speed. So here you just divide by that. And then here you divide by that. So so once you do that, you divide, you do that. So you are going to have the final being what? Okay, so do we have any questions at this point? Any questions? Any questions? Okay. Yes. Oh, because you, that's the moment of inertia of the person, because we are just looking at the, so this is the merry-go-round. So we're just looking at the person as a particle. And the moment of inertia of a particle, remember when we were describing the moment of inertia of a particle, this is how we find the moment of inertia of a particle. So here we're just basically thinking as though this person was a particle, and then, you know, she just changed position. So perhaps you may want to review the that video where we were looking at introducing the moment of inertia. Yeah, but we take the person as a particle. Some questions will even tell you to say take the student or take the person as a particle. But yeah, this one was silent, but that's the idea about it. Yeah. Okay. So then now question B then goes on to say, find the change in the system's rotational kinetic energy caused by her movement to radius 0.5 meters. So here, what's important is knowing when they say system or when they say the student alone. So long as they say the student, then it means that, where there is the case of the moment of inertia, if they say system, okay, if we are finding something for the system, then the moment of inertia that we are going to be using is for the system. And if they say the student, then we are going to use for the student. So, being able to know when to use which is which, I think it's very, very important because you can find someone with a good idea, with a good information, but then they just fail to find their way around this. And then they end up swapping the moment of inertia, and then they make mistakes which are honestly could have been avoided. So that's something that's important to take note of. So we now they're asking us to find what the change in the rotation kinetic energy of the system. So this one is pretty much straightforward. So it's just the change in the kinetic energy. So rotation kinetic energy final minus rotational kinetic energy initial. So what you're going to do for the final is you're going to say the final, the moment of inertia final, the angular speed final, then square, and then that, you got that. Sorry, that should be initial, pardon me. So that should be initial. So that should be initial. Then that. Then we have some, now have to substitute our moment of inertia. So the moment of inertia that we have for the final, remember the final, it's where it became 250. Then the angular speed was what we are just from finding, 4.09 right per second. Then all of this, subtracting this, then moment of inertia, then from there now you are then going to now the initial speed, or the initial angular speed, which was 2 pi rad second, isn't it? Then again that, right? So I usually encourage that you do each of these separately. Then you, like, by separately I mean you find the answer for this, you write it down, and then the answer for this one also, then you just subtract them. That way you reduce the chances of making errors, huh? Okay, so the answer is going to be 920, but I've just done it directly just so that we can save on time. So that's your answer there. Okay, then now question C, the last question, says find the work done on the student as she walks to radius 0.5 meters. So here again, we know that the work done, okay, the work done is going to be the change in the rotational kinetic energy of the student. Take note, because the question is asking us about the work done on the student. Okay, so meaning that the moment of inertia that we are going to be using is going to be for who? For the student. So what we're going to do, we have that. So we have that, and then we have that, then we have that. So what then we are going to do is, what was the final moment of inertia for the girl? The final was 15. Then we have 4.09 rad per second. That, then you close this, then you open this and say 240. Then what you do is that, and then the initial angular speed. So again, like I advise, do those separately. So your answer you're going to get minus 355 joules. Now, you may be wondering, why is it negative? Because they are saying this is the work done on the student, meaning this is the work which was done by the what? By the merry-go-round. So in short, you can say the merry-go-round lost, or rather did this amount of work, or it used this amount of energy on this girl, and that's why it cost the what? The angular speed of what? Of the merry-go-round, because we saw that it decreased, isn't it? So that's something that's important to take note of. So having done that, so that's pretty much about it. So remember, these things we've discussed, we've covered all the concepts, but again, remember, practice is what is going to make you effective, is what's going to make you quick, and you'll be able to, yes. Okay, so like, since for the work done from the previous question, since the work done that we are talking about, they said the work done on the student. So what you have to ask, what two things are in the system? It's the merry-go-round and the girl. So meaning, if they say the work done on the student, meaning it's the work done which is being done by the merry-go-round, then how do we find that? We find the work done to be the change in kinetic rotational, or so in rotational kinetic energy. So it's just the change in the rotational kinetic energy of the what? Of the student. So now what do you do? You for the, do you still have it? Yeah. So you see that for this, the moment of inertia. So first of all, you are talking about the student. So meaning the moment of inertia that you are going to be using is going to be for who? For the student, isn't it? It's going to be for the student. So that's why you've seen that the moment of inertia that we've used for the final and the initials are for the student, not for the system, because we're not talking about the system. And then you've seen now these angular speeds that we've used, those are the same for the system. Why? Because here's the catch. If you are on a bus and the bus is moving at 20 meters per second, that means that you're moving at 20 meters per second as well, isn't it? Yes, the one that asked. So it means that you're moving at 20 meters per second. Yeah, exactly. So that's why the moment of inertia that we are using, we are using the moment of inertia for the student because we want to find the work done. In short, we're trying to find what was the change in the rotational kinetic energy of the student. And we know that it is that change that's equal to the what? To the work done on her. Now, yeah, so that's where we got the moment of inertia. Now, these two angular speeds, we got them. They are the same for the system, right? Because of the example that I've given, to say if you are on a bus, the speed with which the bus is moving, that's also your speed. So that's why the final angular speed and the initial angular speed, they are the same as that of the system. That means they are the same as for the system when we have the student and when we have the merry-go-round both together, right? Because the speed that the system is going to have, the speed that the Marco Polo bus that you are on is going to have, that is going to be your speed as well. That's why when the bus is moving at 100 kilometers per hour, that's also your speed. And when the bus stops, it has got a speed of zero. That's also your speed. You are no longer moving. So that's how we figure out which values to use. So that's why it's always important to pay attention to the question, because I'm sure you may have realized that the question was specifying a student system. The angular speed of the system, angular speed of the student. So, the angular speed of the system, the change in the rotational kinetic energy of the system, and then they say the work done by the merry-go-round, or the work done on the student. So then you know now we are focusing on the student, and so we are going to use the moment of inertia for the student. Has your question been answered? Okay, great. Thank you. You're most welcome. So now we go to this topic. So the questions that we've looked at, those are the different types that you meet, and so that's why I like this book, because it really brings out different concepts. So by just going through them, and remember that Shom's book that I posted on Google Classroom, that's a very important book. That's why they get questions for your exams and even some tutorial sheets actually. So please take note of that. So you may want to take note of that as well. Okay, so having done that, we're now going to solids and liquids. So we are going to start with the states of matter. So from the time when we started school, I think we've been taught that there are three states of matter, these being solid, liquid, and gas. But then we can extend this classification to also include the fourth state of matter, which is plasma. So don't worry, we'll talk about the plasma. For now, let's talk about what we are familiar with. So a solid. So we know that a solid, of course, has got a definite volume and shape. So meaning that a brick, for instance, is going to maintain its familiar shape and size day in, day out, right? So there's nothing like, no, it's too cold, so the brick, looks spherical. We don't have something like that, right? Then for a liquid, has a definite volume but not definite shape, meaning if you get you get a liquid that was in a bucket, you put it in a pot, the shape has changed, but the volume hasn't changed. That's why if you want to pour water from a 2-liter container and you want to pour it in a 1-liter container, you won't. Or if you want to continue, then the rest of the amount of the water will just be falling down, right? Because the volume of the water does not change simply because you've placed it in a particular container, but it's the shape that's going to change. So then one thing that's very, very important is that like we discussed earlier on in biology about the atoms and how they are held by forces. So again, this can be held by different forces, right? Like the atoms in matter, okay? The atoms that make up matter, they are going to be held by different forces. So you can talk about, you can talk about sodium chloride, for instance, right? So that's going to be a solid. And, the sodium and the chloride ions, these are being held by strong attractive forces as a result of the charge differences, isn't it? As a result of the charge differences. So that's an important point to take note of. Okay. Now, okay. So when the external, so now what happens is, I'm sure we've all seen a ball, right? Like a football, for instance. You will realize that for a football, sometimes you can really press so hard on it that it can actually be as though it's compressed a bit, right? But as soon as you let go of your hands, or you let go of your hands, or you let go of your of the foot that you had placed there, you then realize that actually the ball actually returned to its original shape. Okay, so the ball is going to return to its original shape. And so that's something that's very important. So you could actually say as though the ball actually has got some elasticity. And we are going to see this as we proceed in this topic. Now, there's an important classification of solids, because solids can either be classified as either being crystalline or being amorphous. So in a crystalline solid, this is where the atoms are organized in a very ordered manner. So for instance, like the example that I gave for sodium chloride, so there you would have we have got a picture there. So you see the first one there, that's sodium chloride. So yeah, you see that everything is organized really, really well. The atoms are in their fixed positions and all this. Then you are going to have an amorphous solid. So we've already talked about a crystalline solid. Then we now talk about an amorphous. So an amorphous solid is something like a glass, okay? So you see there B, the one that's on the middle there. That's glass, isn't it? So there you see the atoms are arranged all over the place, for lack of a better way. Yeah, so they are arranged all over the place. So that's something important to take note of. And then for any given substance, the liquid state exists at a higher temperature than the solid state. So what basically this says is that, let's say for instance, ice. Ice exists at what? At 0 degrees, isn't it? Or below. But for water to exist, the temperature has to be higher. You get my point, right? The temperature has to be higher. The temperature of the surroundings has to be higher. So that's something that's important to take note of. So the temperature of the surroundings has to be higher. So that's what that point is saying. And then what's then going to happen is that the intermolecular forces in a liquid aren't strong enough to keep the molecules in fixed position. So what's then going to happen is that these molecules are going to be wandering all over the place. And because the intermolecular forces, let's talk about water, for instance, but let's just think of any liquid, there are going to be intermolecular forces. So meaning between the molecules, right, there will be forces, okay? There will be forces amongst them. So now, what's going to happen? Because in a liquid, the intermolecular forces are less. So that's why, fluids can flow anyhow. They can move anyhow because they are not really held in a very, very strong way or in a strong, strong manner as compared to how the solid state is, isn't it? So that's an important point to take note of. Solids and liquids both have the property that when an attempt is made to compress them, strong repulsive atomic forces internally resist the compression. So I'm sure you may have realized this, that if you put water in a bottle and you are trying to compress the bottle, it's hard. Okay, so it's hard to compress a what? It's hard to compress a liquid, and more so for a solid. Okay, so we've talked about the two states of matter. So perhaps you may be wondering why I'm stressing to talk about this. It's because usually for your physics, there are those MCQ questions that they give before you start solving. So these are some of the things that they ask about. Okay, so in the gaseous state, molecules are in constant random motion and exert only weak forces on each other. The average distance between the molecules of a gas is quite large compared with the size of the molecules. So basically what here is just telling us is, in a gas, the distances between the molecules is greater. And what do we know about forces is that the greater the distance, the lesser the force, right? So that's an important point to take note of. So because these gases are more spread out, so that entails that the attractions are going to be less. And so now, as a result of this, because there are a lot of spaces between the gaseous molecules, it means that they are easily compressible. Because what allows for compression? Compression allows when you've got a lot of spaces, so much that you can actually squeeze something, isn't it? So because gases have got a lot of relatively free space, so they are easily compressible, okay? Now let's now talk about the fourth type of state of matter. This is plasma. So how does plasma get formed? So when a gas is heated to high temperature, many of the electrons surrounding each atom are freed from the nucleus. The resulting system is a collection of free electrically charged particles, negatively charged electrons, and positively charged ions. So basically what's happening here is when you get a gas, you heat it, and so what's going to happen is that electrons are going to be knocked out of the atom. I'm sure you may remember that time when we were looking at atomic structure, and we are talking about how we could calculate the energy that it would take a certain photon of light, you know, to be able to knock off an electron from a substance. So this is basically it. So now what's going to happen now? You're going to have a situation where you've got positively charged ions being surrounded by what? By negatively charged electrons. And now such a highly ionized state of matter containing equal amounts of positive and negative charges is called a plasma. So why are they containing equal amounts of electrons and equal amounts of positively charged ions? It's because these electrons are coming from the what? Are coming from the atoms that are being knocked out. So if 10 atoms of the gas have electrons knocked out of them, there are going to be 10 electrons and there are going to be 10 ions, okay? Because those once neutral atoms are now going to be positive ions, okay? So that's about it, huh? So that's an important point. And unlike a neutral gas, the long-range electric and magnetic allow the constituents or the things which are contained in the plasma to interact with each other. So that's something that's important. And plasmas are found inside stars and in accretion disks around black holes, for example, and are far more common than the solid, liquid, and gaseous states because there are far more stars around than any other form of celestial matter. So what this basically says is that, for instance, I'm sure you may have heard of people saying about Mars and everything, you find that for them to just find a solid, they have to search up and down, right? Sometimes they may not even find it, right? Okay, so here on Earth, solid, liquid, gases, they are common. But Earth is just a small amount relative to the entire universe, okay? So, there are a lot of stars, and there's just one Earth, of course, where you've got the solids, liquid in high abundance. So relative to the other amounts of stars, you find that these solid, liquid, and gaseous phases, they are very small relatively. Yeah, so plasma is actually very, very common. So that's about it. So yeah, normal matter, however, may constitute less. So by normal matter, they are talking about solid, liquid, and gas. So normal matter, however, may contribute less than 5% of all matter in the universe. Observations of the last several years point to the existence of an invisible dark matter, which affects the motion of stars orbiting the centers of galaxies. Anyway, the point to take home is that you have plasma, which has got equal positive ions and equal negatively charged electrons, of course. Finally, the rapid acceleration of the expansion of the universe may be driven by an even more mysterious form of matter called dark energy, which may account for over 70% of all matter in the universe. So they are just trying to prove a point that yes, plasma is very abundant. So now we have now to talk about density. So density is very interesting, because as you may remember from grade 12, grade 8, is that you can be able to identify substances based on what? Based on density. And as you see, we'll look at a question where you can actually prove whether a certain object is made of real gold or it's just fake, okay? Or it's just something that is made of maybe iron, you know, silver, and then they just paint it brown, yeah? So density is very important, because density gives identity, okay? So equal masses of aluminium and gold have an important physical difference. So what are we talking about? If you get maybe, let's say, two grams of aluminium and gold, and then you want to calculate their density, you are going to say density is equal to mass over volume. So those masses are the same, right? But you are going to find that the volumes are going to be different, in that you need a lot of aluminium, 7 times volume of aluminium for you to have the same mass as the same amount of gold. So meaning, if let's say we've got a certain amount of, or let's say we've got aluminium and gold, the volume of the aluminium that should be, that to have a mass equal to that of gold is 7 times. Okay, so now this is very interesting, because this then gives us the what? The concept of density. So density is, so density of an object having uniform composition is its mass M divided by its volume. Again, using SI units, we say kilogram per meter cubed. So that's an important point to take note of. Then there is the, now, of course, we know that densities of most solids and liquids will vary slightly with changes in temperature and pressure. Because, you know, I'm sure we discussed when we're looking at normality and molarity, we said, because molarity has got volume in it, and volume can be affected by temperature. So the same way density has got a volume component, and you know, volume can be affected by pressure, and most especially, okay, anyway, by temperature. So you find that densities of certain things is different. That's why you look at biology, we say ice floats on water, right? But it's still the same substance. But you see that simply because of the temperatures, when you get water, you reduce the temperature, it's going to expand. That's why it's a common thing where you put a bottle of water in the freezer, and what happens? The bottle, the water expands, and the bottle, opens up, and sometimes the bottle gets damaged, right? So I think that's something that we've all experienced to some degree. Having done that, now the densities of gases vary greatly, okay? And of course, this makes sense, because gases are always movers, okay? gases are always moving up and down. So even a slight change in what? Even just a slight change in the temperature or the pressure is going to affect a gas very, very much. That's why most bombs, they've got a gaseous component in them. Anyway, but yeah, so take home point, the densities of most liquids and solids vary slightly with changes in temperature and pressure, whereas the densities of gases vary greatly with temperature and pressure changes. Now we now talk about the concept of specific gravity. So we're just bringing out the concept so that when we start the calculations, we know really what we are doing. So specific gravity is a ratio. Now, what do we know about ratios? Ratios have no units. Please, let's get that, right? Okay, so specific gravity of a substance is the ratio of its density to the density of water at 4 degrees Celsius. So why are they being specific? Because we've said that density, what? Density gets affected by what? By temperature and pressure. So they have to specify the temperature. And so specific gravity is the ratio, or rather specific gravity of a substance is the ratio of the substance's density to the density of water at 4 degrees Celsius, which is going to be 1000 kg per cubic meter. So what this basically means is, if we say that a substance has got specific gravity of 3.0, what that basically means is that that object has got a density that is 3 times the density of water at 4 degrees Celsius. That's why to find the density of that substance, you simply multiply it by what? By the density of water. That makes sense, right? So that's how we deal with those things. Then, okay, now we can begin to talk about pressure. So let's say just something, an interesting point. So the force, so we're now looking at those two things that we're having. So there is a block which is in water, and then so the force exerted by a fluid on a submerged object at any point is perpendicular to the surface and increases with depth. So here is the catch. What this says is that, you see, if you place, okay, let's do this. Let's draw this so that we can see it. So what this particular concept that we are from reading is saying, let me just draw this box, this block rather. So you have that, let's just draw it here. Okay, so what they're basically saying is the forces which will be coming, right, are what? Are perpendicular on the surface. So mean that you've got this surface that I'm shading. You've seen that what surface that I'm shading, right? The force is coming what? Perpendicular. You've seen it, right? Then if I now go to this particular on top here, right? You see now the one that I'm shading on top. You see that the force that's hitting it is what? Is perpendicular to its surface. So now that's very important. That's an important point to take note of. Okay. So that's an important point to take note of. Mm-hmm. Okay, so having done that, so let's so the force exerted on exerted by a fluid on an object is always perpendicular to the surfaces of the object. So I've already talked about that. So the pressure at a specific point in a fluid can be measured with a device pictured in that. So that's the device there. You've got the force and you've got the area, but where the money really is here is so they said that the force that is exerted on a fluid, on a submerged object at any point is perpendicular to the surface and increases with depth. So that's why pressure increases with depth, because the area is pretty much going to remain the same, but then as you go down, the force is what is increasing. And as the force is increasing, we know, as this equation tells us, that pressure is equals to what is the force exerted perpendicular on a given surface area. Okay, so then the average pressure is going to be force over area. So that's why we say pressure increases with depth. That's why for those that have gone swimming, you may realize that when you go in water and you come out, someone is talking to you, you can't really hear properly, yeah? Because we went down, there was a lot of pressure that was acting on your eardrum. And so some people may have to do some maneuvers, then you feel as though there's like a pop sound, yeah? And you know, then you're just simply balancing the pressures on both sides of the eardrum. So that's a good point there to take note of. And I'm mentioning it because there's a question in this book that focuses on that thing. Now let's now talk about how really this pressure thing affects things. So have you noticed that if someone steps on your foot with a normal male shoe, okay, so maybe a normal butter shoe, you know, someone steps on your foot and applies, let's say, a force of maybe, let's say 700, maybe, yeah, weight of force of 700 newtons, right? They step on you with that butter shoe. And then a lady comes with a car, with a what, like those to my heels, huh? Like a pointed heel, and then with the same weight steps on you, you may find that actually the lady that stepped on you with that small shoe with a heel that's very, very narrow is going to do pretty much more damage on you. And that's why you may find that when someone is walking on sand with a normal male shoe, they step on the sand, the shoe doesn't really go down very much. But when someone with like a high heel shoe steps on the same sand, what you will see is that the sand will be, you know, like the heel will be going more. It's because the force is the same for both cases, but the area is different. The area on which that force is acting with a high-heeled shoe, the area is smaller because the heel is small, right? So the pressure is more. Whereas with a normal butter shoe, that big whole thing is stepping on what? On the sand. And that's what they are showing us on the far right there. Okay, let me do this one, because yeah, so on the far right there, you see that lady smiling, walking on snow. That's why snowshoes are like that. You've seen those snowshoes, they're extended like that, right? And the aim is to just to increase the surface area so that the chances of this woman, you know, sinking into the snow is reduced. But you want to step on snow with a high-heeled shoe, you're going to go under the snow, right? So with what we've done today, this is introductory to this topic. So yeah, so you look at this man. He's able to sleep on nails. So long as he's doing it with the entire back, he's not feeling a lot of pain. And because there are many, okay, so the pressure on the body weight, you know, is the weight divided by the very small area of the end of the nail. But what's happening now is, since he's distributed himself over several hundred nails, what's happening is that the pressure is reduced because the area, okay, because the total area of all the nails has what? Has increased. So because the area has increased, what are you then seeing? The pressure has decreased. Remember, pressure is equals to force over area. So the area increases, the pressure decreases, right? So that's why this professor is able to sleep on the nails. But if he decides to sit on the nails, it will be more uncomfortable because the area has reduced. And if he decides to step on the nails, the pain will be more. Okay, so that's something that's important to take note of. So from this now, we can now start looking at examples. So those examples, those are things we are going to do next week. Otherwise, we've covered really the fundamentals of this topic. And so, yeah, okay, like the introductory part, anyway. Yeah, so next week, we just look at the examples, and then we can be able to proceed from there. Okay, are there any questions?